Some people call me the space cowboy. Yeah. Some call me the gangster of love. Some people call me Maurice. Cause I speak of the pompous.
What's going on, fellow Cal fans, fellow Tightwads, wherever you are tuning in from on this clear but chilly Sunday afternoon out here at the Concord Cottage in downtown Concord. Thanks again for tuning in, as always. Going to be real interesting to discuss matters on this show going forward, given the fact that at least on the football end, there's not really much to talk about with Cal. But we will recap the Pac-12 Championship and what, of course, happened with a fellow Bay Area College's football team down in the South Bay that some of you that follow this show might be alumni of, that we, of course, have given shout-outs to over on our other sister podcast. Obviously got some basketball stuff to talk about, and obviously, on the football side of things, we also will discuss the recent recruiting efforts by the Cal football program, as well as take a little look ahead to 2021. We're going to save a season in review segment for when we come at you in a little over 2 weeks. More on that later in the show. But anyway, before we get too carried away here, let's go ahead and get the beginnings of show number 6 of the Bear Raid, presented by Tightwad Hill, underway. What's going on, everybody, my fellow Tightwads, fellow Cal Golden Bears fans? It is the 30th and current sitting governor of Tightwad Hill, Keith Salmon, and coming at you on this chilly afternoon at the Concord Cottage. Great show on tap for y'all this afternoon. Still very frustrated by the fact that obviously due to things, you know, obviously unforeseen circumstances beyond everybody's control, still doesn't change the fact that I'm still kind of sitting here over a week later, frustrated with the fact that the Golden Bears are going to finish the season with a 1-3 record because of their games all getting canned and whatnot. But that's just the way things happen. That's the way the cookie crumbles. And obviously, we're going to have to move on and adapt and do stuff. There is obviously some Cal football talk to discuss, at least as far as who we're going to see as far as upcoming new Golden Bears next season and going forward. And obviously, we're going to talk about what went down in the Pac-12 championship and what San Jose State ended up doing as well. Before we get into that, of course, I'm obviously not alone for this edition of the Bear Raid. Still UA for our 6th broadcast is the 29th and previous governor of Tightwad Hill, Tad Dill. The third. So again, those of you out there that know him, help us out. Where is Taddy? Where can he be? Can't show up for a show, but can go up to Tightwad Hill illegally.
Hey, that's pretty good, Keith.
Hey, coming up with that on the fly. And of course, as you hear there, the individual that is here, that is the other third of the Bear Raid's inaugural cast, is of course none other than Donnie Knucklehead Hudson, who of course is the resident here that lives at the spot we're doing this broadcast from, which is of course the Concord Cottage in downtown Concord. What is going on, my friend?
Well, it's a Merry Christmas and it's a Happy New Year. You know, we're working on that. Got a little shopping to do. But you know what? I just want to say, you know, and overall, Stanford got that axe. We'll get it back. But we beat the Ducks, Keith. What about that? You know, that's the big star this year. We beat those Ducks.
Definitely would have been a little bit more enthusiastic for, I think, myself and a lot of us if we could have obviously beat Stanford. Beating Oregon, I think, now kind of ultimately even has a little bit more meaning to it, giving what ended up happening yesterday. And, of course, we're going to get to that here in just a little bit. And like a little quick heads up, obviously, given the fact that we're going to be taking a look at not just one but two football games, and obviously games that have nothing to do with Cal football, but one having to do with the conference and the other one because, hey, it's local news and it's just a great story to follow given what they've accomplished down there at San Jose State with their football program this year.
They call it Sparty, huh?
Yeah.
Sparty.
Sparting up down there, and you know, just everything that they were able to accomplish because of the craziness that's 2020 with COVID going on and whatnot. Just, man, Kind of got a little sidetracked, and I lost where I was actually heading with my process.
We're going to talk about Spartan football. We're going to talk about Cal basketball.
Oh, yeah, definitely we'll get on tap with Cal basketball. We do have a piece planned for what Donnie has now dubbed Keith's Corner, where, of course, we take a look back at some various random moment in the history of Tightwad Hill that could happen once during the show. It could happen multiple times during the show, depending on what hits me at the top of my head. There is one planned addition to Keith's Corner during the course of this show. Who knows if many more come at you. Of course, hopefully you all got a chance to check out last week's, which, of course, was just taking a look back at the yearly warning of the individual known as the Joker. Yes, he has been cited on Tightwad Hill in over a decade, but, hey, still got to be prepared in case that number.
Great story about last week, Keith.
So, yeah, definitely awesome. Make sure, if you haven't seen that, check out last week's recording, and also be sure to check out any of the past editions of the show that you have missed up to this point in time by heading over to A's Fan Radio's YouTube channel. We'll have the URL for that up later in the broadcast, but go make your way over to YouTube. Just type in A's Fan Radio. It's one word, and you can catch all the previous editions of the Bear Raid over there. Let's go ahead and begin things on this edition with the show as we get ready to that's what I was going to mention, is the football talk's going to probably be a little bit longer, at least in this first part of the shows. We are going to be recapping two football games, the first one, of course, being the Pac-12 Championship that ended up going down this past Friday, a game, of course, that originally, prior to COVID, had been planned to be played at the home of the Las Vegas Traders out there in the desert of Las Vegas, Nevada. COVID, I guess, kind of ended up putting a nix on that, because this game ended up being played at the Los Angeles Coliseum on Friday night. And when the final form of this game did end up going down Friday night, it wasn't even the original matchup that was supposed to take place. Obviously, for those of you that were following things earlier in the week, the matchup had originally been slated to have been, of course, the top-seeded team in the Pac-12 South, which was the USC Trojans, who finished out with an undefeated season heading into the Pac-12 Championship game. And then representing the top seed in the Pac-12 North was the Washington Huskies. Well, basically, similar situation to why Cal and Arizona did not end up playing yesterday, which would have been the game that we would have recapped here along with this game, and obviously what San Jose State did. So we actually, had COVID not happened, we might have been recapping three football games during this segment right now at this point in time. But basically, similar situation, the Washington Huskies, because of COVID, positive COVID tests being put under the minimum number of required student athletes in order to even field a team to compete in the game. They ended up bowing out of playing in the Pac-12 Championship, and that, of course, set the tone for the Pac-12 Championship to be the first place Pac-12 South USC Trojans against the second place Pac-12 North Oregon Ducks. So Oregon finding a way, because of COVID, to work its way back into the Pac-12 Championship. Somehow, some way, a little quick take from Donnie here before we take a look at some of the stats that played out over the course of this game.
Frank Zappa said, "Yo ho, watch those Huskies go. Don't eat that yellow snow."
Go ahead.
Oregon got the championship 2 years in a row, but USC was favored, and I thought USC was going to take it. They surprised me. They really dropped the ball.
Well, it was a game where I'm pretty sure, regardless how you were feeling about the Trojans, and just to put it out there for you Cal fans that may not be familiar with us because of not going up the Tightwad Hill or whatever the circumstances is, or you don't follow the A's show that I'm on, the only time normally I will ever root for the USC Trojans, well, there's two given circumstances that I will only root for the Trojans under, and that's one, obviously, when they play Stanford, and two, which kind of probably is an obvious, option as well, is when they play the Dickless Bears. Or for those of you that are wondering who the hell are the Dickless Bears, this is the first time you're tuning in and you've never been up to Tightwad Hill and aren't familiar with the traditions, the Dickless Bears are the UCLA Bruins, because they stole our colors, our fight song, and our mascot, and, good piece of stuff that, that's, I think I've probably done on a Keith's Corner on a previous show. So, yeah, just go back and check out some of the previous podcasts, or come and see us in person, and we'll lay you in on a little bit of the backstory on that. But
I guess Stanford beat them last night, though. UCLA, the Dickless
Bears. Oh, yeah, because for those of you that don't know, obviously, the teams that weren't in the Pac-12 championship ended up playing division or conference games yesterday. That's why Cal was originally scheduled to have been playing Arizona yesterday.
And we, like I said, had not been for that game being canceled due to COVID, we probably would have been recapping that game before touching bases on this. But Donnie kind of getting a little bit ahead of the curve again and already giving you all the heads up that Oregon ended up coming out on top in this one. And we'll go ahead and take a look at what exactly led to that as we go over the scoring summary of what went down in this matchup between the Ducks and the Trojans at the Los Angeles Coliseum. Oregon would get on the board first with 13 minutes and 49 seconds to go in the first quarter when Jason Reed would catch a two-yard pass from Anthony Brown to put the Ducks up 7-0 with 7:14 left to go also in the first quarter. Hunter K-Power would hit catch a 14-yard pass that would put Oregon up 14-0 with just under a minute to go. SC would get on the board at the end of the first quarter to go down 14-7 as Amon-Ron St. Brown caught a 47-yard pass from Keaton Sloven in the closing minutes of the first quarter. Second quarter, with 9 minutes and 45 seconds to go, DJ Johnson would catch a 16-yard pass that would put Oregon up 21-7. USC would score with 4 minutes and 35 seconds left to go when Marquise Steep would go in on a one-yard touchdown run. And, of course, that would go into halftime with SC trailing the Ducks 21-14. Third quarter, the Ducks would score first in that quarter as well with 7 minutes and 20 seconds to go. Travis Dye would catch a four-yard touchdown pass to put Oregon up 28-14. SC would then connect for a field goal with 2 minutes and 28 seconds left to go in the third period, that, of course, being a 21-yard kick from Parker Lewis. SC trails 28-17 at that point in time. And then finally, in the final quarter of this contest, Oregon would hit a field goal with 10 minutes and 26 seconds to go as Henry Cattleman would nail one from 40 yards out that would make the score 31-17. SC would get a touchdown with 6 minutes and 16 seconds left to go as Brew McCoy would catch a 4-yard touchdown pass that would make the score 31-24 at that point. And unfortunately for SC, they weren't able to do anything else after that, as that would end up being the final score in this matchup as Oregon wins the Pac-12 championship in football for the second season in a row, beating the USC Trojans by the final of 31-24 in this one. Passing yard game leaders in this one over on the Ducks side of things, over here on, just want to make sure I'm looking at the right individuals here. Over on SC side, you had Keldon Slovis, who was 28 for 52, 320 yards, 2 touchdowns, 3 picks during this game for the Trojans, while over on the Ducks side, their quarterback, Tyler Sloth, was 8 of 15, 91 yards, 2 touchdowns, and 1 pick over the course of this game. Rushing leaders for the Ducks in this one, Travis Dye, 11 carries on 55 yards. Over on the SC side of things, Stephen Carr was their leading rusher on 12 carries and for 40 yards. Receivers in this one, your leaders for Oregon was D.J. Johnson, 2 receptions, 27 yards. He had 1 touchdown catch in the course of this game. And over on the SC side of things, Brew McCoy was their leading receiver, 6 receptions, 78 yards, and 1 touchdown. As again, the Trojans go down to the Ducks, the second place Ducks, the team that shouldn't have even been in the Pac-12 championship, but again, ended up there because of what happened with the COVID test with Washington. And again, as I just stated, this is 2 years in a row now that them quackers from Oregon have won the Pac-12 title in football.
We play them up north next year, you know. We'll go up there and beat the quackers, you know. You called them the quack. You know, that's my best friend Eric. He calls it quack. When we're down at the flea market, he'll walk by and go quack. He reminds me. That was a tough game right there. I really, like I stated before, I thought USC was going to have more Mac than that. They didn't bring it.
It's most likely a game that I'm feeling based on, you know, many of the individuals that we, of course, associate with from the collective and the group that everyone out there knows and is familiar with as the OGs of Tightwad Hill. Pretty much the majority of everyone up there, with the two exceptions probably being Taddy and our boy Bert. And, you know, before you all get pissed off, you got to remember, Tad and Bert are both Cal alumni, but they also took summer classes at USC. So they're one of the few that can actually claim alumni status at both UC Berkeley and USC. So, that, you know, basically when Cal and SC plays, pretty much, you know, they win either way, regardless who wins the game. So, you know, kind of understandable those two are probably the lone ones that were pulling for SC in this one. You know, because like I said, I only root for SC when they play against Stanford and UCLA. So I did, you know, and as much as I didn't want to pull for the Ducks because of obviously some of the history and, you know, just getting our asses handed to us by the Ducks the last several years, you know, it was almost really a game where I didn't really care, but at the same time, it was kind of nice to see, you know, a team that wasn't even originally supposed to be in this game. And just because of, again, the protocol that's in place due to the coronavirus pandemic, was able to take advantage of that opportunity and upset and beat the team that most likely would have been favored, or I think have won the game even had the Huskies ended up playing with them. So regardless of my personal feelings, hey, shout out to you, Oregon, on defending your Pac-12 title, and hopefully under better circumstances, depending on what goes down next year, maybe we can try to maybe have a shot at trying to derail your chances and also derail the Huskies from the top. I don't know. We'll have to see. More often than not, unfortunately, it's a lot of sad, crying, drunk tear years for us Golden Bear fans. But
they won't
score
31 points next year against us, I'll tell you that. There's no 31-24 up there in Oregon next year. We'll whoop on them.
Oh yeah, but the key then, of course, is just got to make sure the special. You got to make sure that obviously the special teams doesn't have hiccups like it did in the couple games that unfortunately derailed chances for us this year.
I'm sure Mr. Garber was having a beer and enjoying that game right there with a sparkle in his eye.
There is, of course, one more game that we, of course, mentioned that we were going to recap, and this, of course, is a shout out to all of you San Jose State alumni out there who follow things here with this show. If you, of course, also follow A's Fan Radio, shout out, of course, to my boy Chris Townsend, who, of course, I'm good friends with over on the A's side of things. That is, of course, what the San Jose State Spartans were able to accomplish as they pull off the undefeated season in the the Midwestern Conference they play in?
Mountain West.
Mountain Western Conference. My bad. So excuse me for my error on that. I just wanted to make sure.
Think about the Rocky Mountains.
They finish off the Mountain West Conference schedule and championship by going undefeated as they play against a team that for many years was considered probably the lone team out of that entire conference that had any sort of legitimate shot against playing against some of the big house name colleges around the country. That matchup, of course, going down last night between the San Jose State Spartans and the Boise State Broncos. And here's what basically went down with the scoring
summary.
First time
since 1939.
Here goes Donnie getting ahead of things.
I know, 1939. I said it last show.
Right. Anyway, to begin things in this one, the Trojans would get on the board first when Trey Walker would catch a 55-yard touchdown pass from Nick Starkey. I believe that's Nick Starkey or Nick. God, I got to get a better pass.
Joe Starkey.
No, it's not Joe Starkey, you idiot. Starkle, I believe, is what I'm saying here. Anyway, that touchdown reception, of course, putting the Trojans up 7-0 with 8 minutes and 36 seconds left to go. The Broncos would hit a field goal with 3 minutes and 31 seconds to go from Jonah DeMias, 51-yarder, you know, nice, decent, long shot right there for a college kicker. That's probably a guy that might be NFL-bound potentially right there. You know, you don't hear a lot about college kickers really making even 40-plus yarders. You know, when they do, that's usually the guys you suspect to go to the NFL. But Boise State trailing basically there, and that, of course, was the final score of the first quarter right there, trailing San Jose State 7-3 at that point. Things in the second quarter, basically would be pretty much all Trojans in the second half of the game. Four field goals being scored over the course of that second quarter, as that would ultimately give the Spartans a 19-3 lead. The Broncos would end up hitting one as time expired in the first half. Another 50-plus yarder, by the way, from Jonah in this one, as, of course, the Broncos would go into halftime trailing by the score of 19-6. Only score of the third quarter was a Broncos touchdown on a punt return by Avery Williams as he ran one back 69 yards to have the Broncos at that point trail by the score of 19-13. And then basically fourth quarter was pretty much what would end up deciding things here. The Trojans would score a touchdown with 14 minutes and 17 seconds left to go in the final quarter as Isaiah Hamilton would catch a 30-yard touchdown pass that would put the Trojans up 23-13. The Broncos, with 10 minutes and 51 seconds to go, would get a 2-yard touchdown run from Hank Beckmeyer. It would trail 27-20 at that point. But unfortunately for the Broncos, that'd be the last time that they would score in this contest, as the Trojans would score the final points in this one. With 3 minutes and 48 seconds to go, a 1-yard touchdown reception by Derek Deese Jr., which of course would seal the final score in this one, which of course is a 34-20 victory for the San Jose State Spartans, who, by the way, if I'm looking at things right here correctly at what I'm looking at on ESPN, are ranked 24th in the country right now.
Right. They got on there this morning. I thought it was 23rd. Great win by the South Bay team. 1939. Wow. Amazing. I don't know anyone personally that attended school there or anything like that, but shout out to all their alumni and all their fans.
I, of course, mentioned personally, you know, I know Chris Townsend, who I'm familiar with, obviously, from all the, you know, stuff I do with the A's. One of our former co-hosts over on A's Fan Radio is actually also a San Jose State alumni as well. And then there's a couple other members of the fan base who I've, you know, known throughout the years who attended college over there as well. So pretty much I know all those people that I personally know are pretty juiced and pretty high. I'm pretty sure, you know, even today, you know, we're, you know, not even 24 hours removed from that game at this point. And, you know, still definitely got to be a big accomplishment and feel for them. And the crazy thing is the job's not done. They have a bowl game on tap, by the way. And, Donnie, why don't you go ahead and fill everybody in on what that bowl game is that San Jose State has on tap.
That's on Happy New Year, New Year's Eve. They're playing in the bowl game. It's called the Arizona Bowl. And they're playing against Ball State. And I haven't seen the edge, but I'm going to tell you, they're going to go all the way. They haven't lost a game all year. San Jose is going to win the Arizona game this year. It's called the Arizona Bowl, huh?
Definitely would be a good game to check out. And I'm pretty sure, you know, all the individuals we mentioned and all you other San Jose State alumni and obviously current San Jose State students that are going there will definitely be paying attention to that game very closely on December the 31st. And, of course, obviously, along with that and anything else you got planned, remember, ho, 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 stay yo ass at home. We come back from our first break of the afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We will discuss a little Cal football as we, of course, will discuss Cal Gang 21. What's Cal Gang 21, in case you're wondering, and you haven't been following the long things with Cal football on Twitter? Well, you're going to find out from me and my boy Donnie Knucklehead when we come back here at you. And we'll also go ahead and take a look at what's potentially on tap for Cal football in 2021. Obviously, of course, depending on what happens with COVID and whatnot going forward. Obviously, we got some Cal basketball. And, Donnie, you have something else to say before we go to break?
Eat your Wheaties.
Eat your Wheaties. Oh, man. Got a lot
Cal more. Bears got to eat them Wheaties. Come on, basketball.
Cal, you know, somebody's got to do something. Cal basketball talk. Still got some Cal football talk. And, of course, the Keith's Corner segment will be coming at you to lead things off. We come back at you here from the first break of the afternoon. Don't go anywhere, folks. Show number 6 of the Bear Raid, presented by Tightwad Hill, will be right back at you here in a bit on twitch.tv/A's Fan Radio, live from the Concord Cottage in downtown Concord, California.
We're down here in Concord. It's fresh in the cottage. 52 degrees. Hey, you know, 95.7 out there. Shout out to the 95.7 gang. And they make about the, you know, the temperature in the Bay Area. So, you know, in downtown Downeyville today, 51 degrees on the Yuba River. Okay, so, you know, I already gave all the shout-outs to the Spartans, to the Ducks. That's the only time you're ever going to hear me talk good about the Ducks, by the way.
Probably be one of the few times you probably hear me even talk good about the Ducks as well. And, you know, it's only because of the fact that they were playing USC in the championship game. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. It is, of course, show number 6 of the Bear Raid presented by Tightwad Hill. It is, of course, the 30th and current sitting governor of Tightwad Hill, Keith Salmon. And I'm joined, of course, by one of the thirds of this podcast, which, of course, is Donnie Knucklehead Hudson. We, of course, are still waiting the eventual showing of the other member of this show, which is Tad Dillinger III. Taddy, of course, amongst those that went up the Tightwad Hill illegally in 2020. Sorry to call you out, Taddy, but, hey, it's a little hard not to when your ugly mug is in crystal clear view of everybody on TV. You know,
if we all get a shot, maybe we can see each other on the spring game.
Yeah, maybe, and we'll get more into that. And, you know, who knows if they even play a spring game, you know, because of that. Because remember, they ended up canceling the spring game this year because of that. Before we get into what is, for those of you that are probably still sitting there and wondering what is Cal Gang 2020, I'm, of course, going to get into what I had just hinted at, which is, of course, the this edition of Keith's Corner, where we take a look at and we discuss some of the various integral parts and urban myths, legends, tellings, you know, half-truths, truths. Who knows if they're even true, depending on who you're hearing stuff from at this point in time. Keith's Corner basically focuses on the oral history that is the 97 going on next year to be 98-year-old pile of dirt that is Tightwad Hill. And the one for this edition of the show that at least we have planned right now, as I've mentioned to you before, other moments could hit me out of the top of the, you know, out of nowhere and out of the blue over the course of these shows. But I'm going to try to at least set it up so there's one planned for every show. This one, of course, is a recent one that went down as recently as last season. So you guys are getting a recent bit of Tightwad Hill history and lore and joke mythos on this edition of Keith's Corner. I forgot exactly at what point in time it was last year. I want to say this was probably near the middle to the end of the season. It was not too long after the canopy that we had put up there had fallen apart. We had tried to do a whole bunch of different things to try to reestablish it, put it back up, and just no matter what, the wind would destroy it. I'm not surprised if some of the local unhoused inhabitants of Berkeley might have.
I remember for one thing, it didn't rain last year. It was great.
Well, yeah,
didn't have a single rainy game.
That was definitely one advantage of the whole year as well. But basically, from what I remember, the day that this incident went down that we're about to discuss, at that point in time, we had basically had taken what was left of the canopy, which had parts of it nailed into that fallen tree and elsewhere. And I want to say Taddy, Donnie, and maybe Bert basically went up to some of the trees that are up back behind where the 50 Club is and basically tied up the canopy in the branches and, you know, put up a little makeshift dome, like sunshade over there. So we're over there hanging out. And Donnie that day had also brought a whole bunch of meat cuts that he had acquired, I think, from either some event he had catered the day before or it was something that he cooked here. He could probably get into a little bit more details himself when I turn the mic over here to him. But basically, he's sitting there. He's adding a little bit more seasoning to it. He's cutting it, you know, cutting it up and getting ready to offer it to everybody. And Bert's making his way up the up to where we're at, where this, you know, what's left of the canopy is hanging up in the branches at this point in time. And he's getting ready for one of our pregame little medical research sessions. And as he's making his way up there, out of the blue, my man over here hollers down at him, "Hey, Bert, you want to try a piece of my meat?" All you hear is just everybody that was on Tightwad Hill at that point erupt into just utter straight laughter. And even Donnie, you know, you got Taddy over there going like, "Donnie, what's wrong with you?" And, you know, just it was complete crazy, you know.
And you guys haven't stopped. I haven't heard the end of it since.
Piece of Donnie's meat up beside your cheeks.
Earlier
that was the song Taddy came up with that day, by the way, y'all.
Earlier today when Keith was reminding me about the show and we went over the show before the show, he said, "I'm going to talk about that story." And I thought he was talking about an old story when one time I brought like an 8-pound pork roast up there. And we'll get Gary on a show or one time. Gary can quote him. He'll tell the story of the 8-pound pork roast.
Oh, yeah. Definitely, you know, individuals like Gary, Bert, Harrison, a lot of the other OGs out there when we're all able to safely
gather again.
You
know, we get hungry up on that hill. We're up there, you know, 6-8 hours sometimes.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yes.
We got to bring our food.
Dude, sometimes earlier than that, I've mentioned before on this show and previous shows and those of you out there that have followed me on social media for years, there's been times in the past where me and some of the guys would camp out the night before the game. You know, me and a couple of the guys did it a few times for the big game during the mid-2000s. We did it a couple times. I think we did it once or twice for USC Also,
it's camping
so,
without flame, so yeah. though, because you can't have a campfire.
Oh, yeah. We obviously knew that. And we, you know, from being, you know, even at that, we, duh, dude, because we didn't want to set the place on fire. That's the last thing we would have wanted. That would have been worse than the whole situation that we used to deal with the Joker back then. The Joker would have looked like, you know, preschoolish crap to that if that would have happened. But, you know, but yeah, sometimes, obviously, as Donnie mentioned, there's several hours that were up there, sometimes a whole day and sometimes almost, you know, a full 24-hour day, depending on certain situations in the past. So definitely, if we don't have the means or the needs to go down to some of the stores nearby to buy stuff, it's smart to bring that stuff up. And, you know, speaking of which, I did mention to it.
Tad and his cheese. You know, I miss his cheese.
What was it that day that you brought up there when this whole "do you want a piece of my meat" incident went down?
Well, you know, I'm famous for stuff that I say, and I don't always mean it like that. I'm so innocent. But I brought a really nice spread, and I wanted everyone to try it, and then it just came out wrong. What can I say?
Hey, it just ends up happening, and, you know,
it's
again.
Funny.
Well, of course, you know, it's kind of expected, unfortunately, if, you know, on a place like Tightwad Hill or, you know, a college football environment that, you know, something like that is said, unfortunately, the first direction everybody's mind's going to go in, and unfortunately, is the gutter. Let's just be real about that in a situation
right.
like that.
Well, that's you guys. I'm a nice guy. I'm Ice Guy Donnie from Concord.
That happens.
You know, we're innocent out here in Concord. Just come on out one time.
That is this edition of Keith's Corner. May not be the last Keith's Corner during the course of the show. You know, you never know. Like I said, some random moment can just hit me out of the blue over the course of things on here. Let's go ahead now and get into the promised Cal football talk for this edition of the show. And that's, of course, talking about Cal Gang 21, which, of course, Cal Gang is basically what the University of California refers to the football recruits, apparently, that are brought in each year. So Cal Gang 21 is basically the group of incoming freshmen that were signed on National Signing Day this year, which, of course, went down on Wednesday. And
pretty hot group this year, huh,
Keith? Definitely. Basically, just to go over some of the notes here that were released by Cal earlier in the week, head coach Justin Wilcox announced, of course, on Wednesday, the first 19 members of Cal's 2021 recruiting class ended up signing with the program. That right now, those of you, of course, out there are taking a look at the images of that group. The class is currently ranked 20th nationally, according to ESPN, which is the Golden Bears' highest-ranked class since Cal was ranked 15th nationally by 24/7 Sports and was ESPN's number 18th class in 2011. The class includes 8 four-star recruits, so there's the answer to a question that Donnie was asking to me off-air before we started the broadcast today. It includes 8 four-star recruits and 7, excuse me, 8 four-star recruits with 7 ranked among the nation's top 300 players by at least one of the primary recruiting outlets, including wide receiver J. Michael Stervadant, who's number 104, quarterback Kia Milner, who, of course, was known for recently a couple weeks back, and my A's fan radio co-host actually posted this, I guess, in a recent high school game. He threw a ridiculous behind-the-back pass for a touchdown reception in one of his high school games that he was playing, and I think it might have
I look forward to him. Anybody's got trickery, bring it.
Yeah. Milner, by the way, he's currently ranked 100.
Milner?
Milner.
Oh, he was in all those Disney movies.
Oh, my God.
You remember Milner?
Damn
That's
it.
Old 60s movies.
Damn it. Milner currently is ranked 114th by ESPN. Tight end Jeremiah Terry, who's 162 on 247 Sports. Wide receiver Maven Anderson, who's 196 on 247 Sports. Caleb Elarms Ors. He's a linebacker. He's ranked 218th by 247 Sports. Defensive lineman Akilo Calhoun, who's ranked 224th by 247 Sports. And defensive lineman Derek Wilkins, who's ranked 375th by 247 Sports. Outside linebacker Bastian Sweeney is the other four-star recipient in the class. All 19 players in the class are high school seniors, including a strong local contingent of a dozen that played their most recent pro or prep football at California high schools before the pandemic in Anderson, who, of course, went to Mission Viejo. Calhoun, he went to Liberty. Ermis Orr went to Monroe Catholic. Liu Malgon Hearns, who went to De La Salle. So there's another answer to your questions you were asking about some De La Salle guys earlier as well. Defensive back Caleb Higgs, Higgins, he went to Folsom. As I'm getting all tongue-twisted there. Offensive lineman Ryan Lang, who's from Pittsburgh. Tight end Kaloki Lato, who's from Jesuit. Linebacker Moses.
This kid Lang, you better watch out for this kid Lang. I heard about him.
Linebacker Moses Olado, who's from Columbus Oaks. Linebacker Nate Rachuta, who's from Monta Vista. Terry, who, of course, as much as those earlier, is from Kennedy. Wilkins is from Santa Margarita Catholic. And Miley Williams, who's from Bishop Almany. So pretty impressive.
They're trying to keep it local. I heard they were going to try to do that under Wilcox. He's finally living up to that, eh?
Oh, yeah, definitely, no doubt. But, I mean, ultimately, at the same time, especially, and this is one of the biggest gripes I've heard from my boy Boss Man, who co-hosts Ace Fan Radio with me. He's a OG from Tightwad Hill. He hasn't been up to the hill since the late 90s because of going off to school and having a family of his own since then and just other commitments because of his job profession. But his biggest gripe as a Cal fan is he definitely loves seeing when they recruit locally, but if Cal ultimately wants to ever make a bigger presence on the national stage, they're going to have to try to expand some of that national recruitment a little more as well. But I definitely love the
fact. I don't know about that. We got some big farm boys out here in Danville.
Oh, yeah. I'm not saying you don't got that big farm talent here, but, I'm saying, there's a lot of stuff out there you can look, and you can never know what you can find out there. I mean, you had a guy that, that bounced around to whole different places that ended up with this team this year that ended up graduating with the school as well. But definitely for me, the one guy that I definitely am going to be keeping an eye on is Kia Milner, who,
right.
Definitely is probably going to be basically, prepped and basically set up to possibly most likely be the guy who probably ends up succeeding Chase Garbers. And given the fact that, not me so much, but there are some out there that, people that we know that follow this show and other Cal fans that I've talked to and just some of the talk that I see out there on social media, there are some that feel, even with the whole shortened season, do feel to some extent that Chase may have regressed a little bit this year. So depending on, what this kid and the kid does between now and when things, come down with the spring game and over the summer and going up there, Chase may want to be watching his back, man, because this Milner kid might give Chase a run for his money for the starting quarterback job next year, potentially.
No way. Chase Garber's going to go high in the draft in 22, and he'll end up, you heard it here first, Knucklehead's prediction. He's going to be a Cincinnati Bengal, and he's going to run. That kid's can scrambleitis.
Why do you want Chase to go and play for the Bungles? That's
him,
jacked up, man.
No, it's not a matter of I want him to. That's where he'll end up because
the
of Bungles. The way the draft works out.
The Bungles.
Okay,
it's messed
an
up.
Exclusive. You call him, what do they call him?
Bear Raid Radio Exclusives?
I was going to call it a Bear Hill.
Bear Hill Bear Hill. I don't think we have a Bear Hill anywhere that I'm aware of, unless your brother took over a spot and named it Bear Hill. Anyway, but other bit of Cal football talk we wanted to get into as well. As I mentioned, we decided that we're going to go ahead and save the season in review of Cal football for the next edition of the show, which we'll have a little bit more word on that. I got to take a look at things exactly ahead here.
Yeah,
on the
Wilcox
calendar.
On next show, you said?
I did not say we were going to have Wilcox on the next show. It would be nice, but I don't think we're going to have to build a little bit more credibility.
What about Steph Curry? Is he going to come on?
We're going to have to.
I heard Steph Curry's heavy on the mics now. He wants to be a reporter and an announcer like us.
Who knows? But what I'm alluding to is we're going to need to, just like what I did with A's Fan Radio, we're going to have to probably build a little bit more credibility with the Bear Raid before we get to that point in time.
I got connections, Keith. I told you, okay. I got the connections.
Well, since you want to be over there talking about your connections, why don't you go ahead as well and take over there on the mic there and let everybody know at least how things are looking right now, as if we're presuming that things will be under control with COVID next year. What's it looking like for Cal football's 2021 schedule, at least from what's floating around out there right now?
Well, about 8-4. How do you like those dogs? 8 victories. I'm looking at 8 victories.
I didn't ask for a record prediction, you knucklehead. I asked what is the schedule matchup looking like.
Well, it's looking like 8-4.
There he goes. There he goes, getting ahead of himself again.
8-4. We're going to beat Nevada out the gate. Come on, Nevada. Bring them on. We're going to play them like you alluded to earlier on September 4th. Beautiful Saturday. It'll probably be sunshine. Keith will be out there with his you know, with his shirt off for all I know.
Yeah, right.
It'll be a great day.
Do you want me to blind all of Berkeley with my whiteness, my friend?
Well, you know. And then we got to go on the road out there to Texas to play TCU. You know, we've been talking about playing those guys. They said that they're going to play us and we're going to play them back and forth, two games. It just didn't come to fruition this year. We were supposed to play them this year. So that'll be on 9-1-1, September 11th. And then they got us, you know, don't hide. Sac State's coming to town. I'm sure they're going to bring their weapons. That's September 18th. And after that, they haven't actually made the schedule. Although I know we're not going to play Utah, and we won't be playing those Arizona State Sun Devils.
Even though they don't have dates set up, who do they have lined up as far as who we will be playing as far as what the Pac-12 schedule looks
well,
like?
Well, they got it in this list. They got it Arizona, Colorado, Oregon State Beaver, the USC struggling kids down there, and then we got Washington State, Oregon Duck, Stanford, UCLA, and Washington will end up the season there. Washington.
So
we'll beat the shit out of Washington, eh?
Yeah, maybe we'll have to see. I have a buddy up there that might think otherwise in regards to that. Obviously, as far as the Pac-12 schedule, we'll have to wait and see what things look like as far as dates. Obviously, you're going to probably have to factor in probably a week or a couple bye weeks at that point in time. And also, you got to just factor in the reality of who the hell knows what things are going to even look like come next September as far as this COVID-19 pandemic goes. A lot of that's probably going to hinge on where things are as far as the vaccine is being issued out to people and how many have it, if it's still a big issue with positive tests affecting the programs. You know, you got a lot of question marks going on. You know, again, it would be, you know, it'd be nice, you know, sitting here keeping your fingers crossed thinking that September 4th we're all going to be getting together, you know, maybe spread out and masked up, you know, because they'll probably have a limited capacity, you know, set up probably initially, and probably will extend, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if the athletic department extends the same to us to implement some sort of limited thing up there, you know, try to work in, you know, in step with the college next year. If there's some sort of limited capacity up there, obviously do the same thing up there.
That's
you know,
right.
Basically pray and hope that somehow, some way we're able to go back to Cal football as we knew it pre-COVID in 2021. But again, who knows? But, you know, you can't help but also still try to look ahead at what's going on. You know, it's a little early, I think, to say that they'll have an 8-4 record, Donnie. I like the optimism. I'm not going to hate on that. But
it looks like we'll be down in Palo Alto, though. You're going to the game with me. Where do you hang out before those games, Keith?
Usually, all the times I've gone out there, I hang out. I just chill in the Grove.
That was the term I was looking
for. I've been out there twice, and both times I've went out there, I've hung out in the Grove. The first year I went, it was just myself and Tad, and we basically chilled next to a tree in the Grove and had the game on the radio and had a big-ass pizza that we had picked up in Berkeley before we made our way over there. I forgot if we got it from Fat Slice or what was Blondie's. I think it's called Abe's Pizza now, what used to be Blondie's over there.
I love Abe's.
But it's basically the same pizza, just a different name now. But, yeah, so we first time I went over there was just me and Tad. We had the game on the radio, and then last year, last year being 2019, not this previous season, I linked up with a couple of the guys that I know from A's games and hung out in the Grove, and they had a generator and a satellite, and we watched the game on the TV, so...
We'll go to the Grove.
Oh yeah. Obviously, I'm down for doing that as long as it's safe to do that.
What do you want to have, sandwiches and beer?
Hey, we'll figure out something. Maybe we can link up with a couple people and have them come and grill. Hell, maybe we can.
Raviolis?
Not right. Oh, my God, Donnie. Piece of your meat. Piece of your
I'm
meat.
I'm going to bring a big piece of meat.
Donnie's meat.
I'm going to bring a big piece of meat. For that event, we got to get the axe back.
Oh, definitely no doubt with that. But, yeah. I think a little premature to say 8-4, but definitely, obviously, giving.
All right, 9-3.
You want to up the odds now.
Yeah,
okay,
we got a varsity quarterback in there. My man, senior, Mr. Chase, going to chase him around this year.
Yeah, there could be some questions out there from people that follow the show and others out there regards to that.
My Cincinnati Bengal?
Your Cincinnati Bungle. Here you go again. But yeah, I think it's a little premature to be bestowing what potential records on there.
I like the future.
I'm not blaming you for that, but at the same time, I hope that guys in the program are having those type of expectations, because you're definitely, I think, from at least definitely the fans' perspective, are going to be looking to want to see this program bounce back in 2021, regardless if a lot of the reasons that the season in 2020 played out the way it did was because of COVID, unfortunately.
And that Brown, that Chris Brown, that running back, man, he's NFL. He's got NFL on his back.
Definitely, no doubt.
What's he, a sophomore right now?
I forgot what he is.
Well, we got Brown next year, I'm pretty sure, and he's going to kick some booty.
Yeah. But again, the definitely will be interesting to see if it gets to that point. Keep your fingers crossed that that is how basically things will play out next year. If for some reason COVID is still running amok at that point in time, I just hope the Pac-12 is a lot smarter than it was this year and doesn't decide to wait until November to start the damn season again, and either runs with that schedule with whatever they had in place as far as protocol this year, or if they have to, just knock out the non-conference games and just play the Pac-12 schedule next year. You know, just one way or another, dude, it's going to be real interesting to see how this all pans out, and definitely going to be a year to look forward to and hope that whatever ends up being the 2021 season next year, Cal bounces back.
All right, we're getting towards the end of the next segment, or this segment, I mean. And you know what I want to say? This segment has actually been sponsored by and saluted out to Rick Monday, A's Fan Radio, 2021. Unbelievable. Rick Monday.
We come back from this next break here on this afternoon's show. We're going to go ahead and check in on what the Lady Golden Bears and the Men's Golden Bears have been up to. That's right. We got Cal basketball on tap for you coming next at your way. And we're also going to go and take a look at the standings for the Pac-12 basketball programs and also what the final standings ended up being for the Pac-12 football conference in 2020. Don't go anywhere, folks. Show number 6 of the Bear Raid presented by Tightwad Hill will be coming right back at you here in a bit.
You got it. You got it.
It's the Bear Raid live and in your face in Concord, California.
It's a Cal Fan Ran podcast. It's sponsored by a pile of dirt, and it's coming from you from a cottage from the turn of the 19th century in downtown Concord. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to show number 6 of the Bear Raid presented by Tightwad Hill. Of course, hosted today by the 30th and current sitting governor of Tightwad Hill, Keith Salmonen. Oh, shit! That's me, bro! And, of course, my co-host for this afternoon's show, the other third of the Bear Raid podcast cast, Donnie Knucklehead Hudson. We're still, of course, waiting for Tad Dillinger III to join us on this show. Where is Taddy? Where could he be?
I got you a cigar from Tennessee.
Get your ass to Concord, you dumbass. Again, ladies and gentlemen, if any of you out there happen to see our dear friend Taddy, tell him to get his butt out here or get in contact with myself or Donnie. Make sure, of course, to let him know, too, that he takes a COVID test. That way we know that he didn't catch COVID when he went up to Taiwan illegally a couple weeks ago. This is probably, I hate to say it, this would probably would be about the time that some would probably be showing symptoms, unfortunately, from that point in time if anyone did have it up there.
I think we need to get him a standard baseball hat, you know, a cap to wear instead of that straw hat thing. This isn't gay 90s pizza. We're going to get him a regular hat for next year.
The reality is I do not see him changing over from that straw hat anytime soon.
Forced a baseball cap.
The only way I think you could get him to get out of that straw hat is if you go ahead and get a hold of those, like, no shit, like a legit old school, like 1920s, 1930s, face maskless leather Cal football program helmet. I don't know where you're going to get a hold of one of those now at this point in time unless you break into the archives and steal one. Hey, I'm not encouraging anybody to do this, by the way, so if you do this and you do get caught, I did not encourage this. You dumbasses did this on your own, but
hasn't he been known to wear a Yankee hat, though, too?
Oh, yeah, of course, because
I've seen the Yankee. We got a bunch of arguments, if I think about it, about the A's and the Yankees.
Oh, yeah, because Taddy is a Yankee fan, unfortunately. But just, damn, hey, it. That comes with the territory of a Cal alumni that happens to hail from New York.
Has
I guess
he ever
say
gone
that
to the A's game with you?
Yeah, he's gone with me to several A's games over the years, in fact.
Just
so
checking on that. Making sure.
Let's go ahead, and I'm going to turn things over here to my man Donnie. Hey, what did the Lady Golden Bears do recently?
Just win. You know, I don't know that much about the Cal girls right now. You know, I couldn't pay my cable bill. Keith, you got about $20 I can borrow for my cable bill.
Are you kidding me, dude? You couldn't look this up?
Okay, $22.
You don't have any notes for this at all?
I have no notes about my girls.
What the hell is wrong with you,
Matt? It's Christmas week. A lot of Kahlua, eggnog, Christmas songs. You know, hey, I've been listening to the Christmas songs on the radio. Makes me feel old. I also slipped in a birthday last week. Damn it.
Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Donnie sucks.
That's all right. Hey, you know,
it's okay, my friend. I got you,
you got
covered.
It. You got the magic thumb over there.
I do. I do actually have what ended up being the matchup and final score for yesterday's contest for your Lady Golden Bears. Just want to double check and make sure that was the only game that they had on tap.
Maybe Wheaties had paid my cable bill. Can you get hold of that? I keep telling you about Wheaties. You got to eat your Wheaties. You know why? We need a sponsor.
We do have a sponsor, a pile of dirt that's 97 years. I get what you're saying.
Unfortunately, that pile of dirt can't pay my cable bill.
That is true. Anyway, the most recent matchup for your Lady Golden Bears, they've only played one game since the last time we came at you, and that matchup going down in L.A., as they, of course, had a matchup at 12 noon yesterday.
Louisiana?
No, dude, they were in Los Angeles.
Oh, L.A.
Oh, my God.
That L.A.
They were at the Poly Pavilion in L.A. They were taking on the Lady Dickless Bears. The Lady.
Oh, yeah,
see,
yeah.
The
we
lady
talked about that last show. What happened?
That was not last. How could that have been last?
Yeah, you brought it up. No, you said they were going to play the Lady Dickless
I brought
Bears.
Up that they were going to play the Lady Dickless Bears. I'm bringing it up now. Since you didn't take your notes for this one.
That's right.
And I'm praying and hoping that you at least took your notes for the men's game. I guess we're going to find out eventually here in a bit when we get to that.
The men's.
We're not on the men's yet, so hold the hell on. Damn it, let's get through the women for the ladies first.
Lady Dons?
Damn it, Donnie. Anyway, here's what went down yesterday between your Lady Golden Bears and the Lady UCLA Dickless Bears. Kind of unfortunately had a similar reminiscence and eerie finale to it as the Stanford game did that we recapped on last week's show. That's why you were probably thinking there was a similarity, because unfortunately UCLA kicked the crap out of the Lady Golden Bears as they fell yesterday afternoon in L.A. by the final of 71-37 in this contest.
Wow, I didn't know.
Your top.
I took yesterday off too.
You knucklehead! You shouldn't have. You could have at least glazed over the stats a little bit, so you had a little bit of notes for this one. Anyway, top scorer for Cal in this one was Diala Daniels, who had 14 points over 40 minutes. She was 4 of 16 from the field and also 5 of 8 from the free throw line. Over on the UCLA side of things, Natalie Cho was their top scorer, as was Michelia Onuera, who both had 18 points. Chow had was in there for 37 minutes, 17 of 13 from the field, and was also 4 of 8 from the three-point line, while Michelia was in there for 26 minutes, 7 of 16 from the field, 1 of 3 from the beyond the arc, and was 3 of 4 from the free throw line. So a little bit of an eerily unfortunate kind of a Groundhog Day game for your Lady Golden Bears in this one. It basically played out the same way the game against the Lady Ferd played out.
Well, that's why my girls didn't text me, because they got their booties handed to them, and that's not good. I think they were ashamed a little bit, so they didn't contact me. You know, I'm being facetious. But, you know, you ready to move on to the men? The men are looking great.
I will as soon as I let everybody know what's going to be going down for your ladies between now and when we come at everybody for our next show, which I'll go ahead and let everybody know right now. We're going to go and take 2 weeks off for the holidays and bring show number show at you as of right now, scheduled it for December, or not December, excuse me. Slating right now, as of this point in time, that show number 7 would go down on January 10th. So, yeah, that's about 2 weeks from now,
lucky
roughly.
Lucky seven, huh?
I guess so. Here's what the Lady Golden Bears have on tap between now and then. They are playing tomorrow at 2 p.m. down at the Galen Center in L.A. as they will take on the Lady USC Trojans. Their next game after that is on New Year's as they're slated to play Arizona State in Tempe, Arizona. Start time of that game has not been announced yet, as have the start times for any of the other upcoming games. So after they play SC, of course, on the 21st, they will play at Arizona State on January 1st. They will then play at Arizona on January the 3rd. They will come back to Berkeley to play the Oregon State Beavers at the Haas Pavilion on January the 8th. And then, of course, when we come at you for the next edition of the Bear Raid on January 10th, they will be hosting the Lady Ducks at the Haas Pavilion.
Wow, they could win about three of those four games coming up, in my eyes.
Well, we'll definitely have to see about that possibility when we take a look at what the standings are looking like for the ladies. Now, since you were obviously in such a rush to get it, and you apparently took better notes with this than you did with the ladies, which I'm kind of shocked with because you were hyping up how you love the ladies more
Bradley,
than the men.
Bradley, Bradley.
What were the men up
to? You need to know. It's Mr. Bradley, you know. On Tuesday, the 22nd, 3 days before Christmas at 2 p.m., we're playing against Seattle, University of Seattle. You know, the Bears are 4-4. I'm looking ahead at this schedule. We're going to go right into Pac-12 in about a week. Heck, in about a week, we could be, you know, 8-4. Pretty optimistic. You know, Donnie always likes to go for the optimism, and what else could I do? I wear the blue and gold. Go ahead, Keith.
Three members of the Cal men's basketball program, by the way, are now at 1,000 points in their career. One of those, of course, being Mikella Foreman, who, of course, hit the buzzer-beater three-pointer that beat USF last week. Matt Bradley is also among those as well. And I can't remember the name of who was the third individual that was amongst those that got 1,000 points.
It was Kwani. Was it Kwani, or was it Foreman? It was Foreman, huh?
I just said Foreman, dude.
Okay,
I said
so it was Kwani.
I think it was his last name, like Riley or something like that, or Reilly or
Bentley.
Ryan that was
Bentley, 6'5" guard. He wears 00. Jim Otto. He wears the Jim Otto number.
Nice. Well, Donnie, of course, getting a little ahead of himself yet again there is, of course.
I like to do that, Keith. I got to work on it. I'm going to go back to school.
Well, did you take notes for the fact that the men played last night or yesterday at 2 p.m.?
No, I was had the day off.
Yesterday they were playing against the Matadors down there in or they were playing the hostel. They were playing at the Houseville, and they were playing the CSUN Matadors. I believe that's
Heard of them.
I believe that's from
the Mats
down in SoCal. I believe I want to say I'm having a brain fart where they are. I think that's my co-host's alma mater from down in. I don't know why I'm having a brain fart there. But anyway, the men played last night. The men won, by the way, by the final of 87-56 in that one. Of course, as Donnie mentioned, improving to
four. Does that make it 4-4 or is that 5-4?
That makes them 4-4 overall.
They're still, I have that right.
They still, unfortunately, haven't gotten a Pac-12 win at this point, but we'll get more into that, obviously, when we take a look at the standings. CSUN, of course, plays in the Big West Conference. They're currently 3-3 overall after this one. Top scorer for the Golden Bears in this one was Mikella Foreman. He had 23 points in 25 minutes. He was 7 of 14 from the field, 4 of 8 from beyond the arc, and he was 5 of 6 from the free throw line in this contest. The Matadors' top scorer was TJ Starks, who had 13 points in 27 minutes. He was 3 of 7 from the field, 1 of 2 from beyond the arc, and a perfect 6 for 6 from the free throw line. Upcoming games for your California Golden Bears men's basketball program between now and when we come at you for the next edition of the Bear Raid on January the 10th. They were slated to play Boston College on the 22nd. That game has been canceled now, probably guessing COVID-related stuff.
BC, I saw that.
Okay, so as Donnie mentioned, they will instead now be playing Seattle on December the 22nd at the Haas Pavilion at 2 p.m. On New Year's Eve, December the 31st at 7 p.m., they will be up in Eugene, Oregon at the Matthew Knight Arena taking on the Oregon Ducks. January 2nd at 3 p.m., they'll be at the Gill Coliseum in Corvallis, Oregon, taking on the Oregon State Beavers. They'll be back at the Haas on January the 7th. That'll be a Tuesday at a to-be-determined tip-off time against Washington State. And then the day before the next edition on the Bear Raid on January the 9th, they'll be hosting the Huskies in a 12 p.m. tip-off at the Haas Pavilion.
And they really do get to 8-4. I won't be able to sit down for that show. Because, you know, realistically, that's a hot schedule to get to play.
Definitely will be, and I hope that you are better attuned with your notes, damn it, between now and then. You were doing so good with your notes for both the ladies and the men, and then just this week, Ducklehead decided to be a space cadet.
I turned 38 I was 38 this year.
I thought you turned 61 this year.
Oh, shit.
Now you're starting to sound like my bleacher uncle and, you know, saying that he's the same. There was a three-year period where my bleacher uncle kept telling everybody he was like 58 or 50, you know, 50-something for like 3 years in a row or some crazy crap like that.
38 special.
38 special. Anyway, that concludes this edition of Basketball Talk for the Bear Raid. And that means, of course, we are coming up on our final break of this afternoon's broadcast. We come back, we will go ahead and take a look at what the most recent standings are around the Pac-12. We also will touch bases quick on some of the pro Bears that excelled last week in the National Football League in the debut of the Bear Raids, the Pro Bear segment here on the Bear Raid, which, of course, I promised on last week's show and kind of dropped the ball on. So we got that. The standings for the final standings for football, the standings for the lady basketball program, the men's basketball program, and, of course, mine and Donnie's final thoughts before we punch out from the Concord Cottage for the afternoon. Don't go anywhere. Final break coming at you, and then final segment following that, here on show number 6 of the Bear Raid, presented by Tightwad Hill. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, as we get ready to close up shop here and come at you with the final segment of this afternoon's
Feliz Navidad.
I think Donnie's over here having to insert the Christmas music. I was hoping probably I was going to put Christmas music on here. I ended up not doing that for this show. But
Jose Feliciano, man.
Hey, for those of you that want to tune in, of course, to A's Fan Radio tomorrow night, I do have plans to probably most likely have a Christmas soundtrack mix on that, because I usually have always traditionally done that with...
hey, who's that crazy lady outside screaming out there?
I don't know. I was about to ask you about that. For those of you, obviously... It
reminds me of the Tenderloin. This is supposed to be quiet down here in Concord.
Here's a little Bear Raid radio exclusive coming at you that you're only going to get right here and the now. As Donnie's mentioning, he brought this up to me before we went on here. Apparently, out in front of the Concord Cottage right now is some... lady that's just screaming, being
she's
all
over
crazy.
In front of the liquor store,
she's,
you know.
Over what exactly is she doing?
She's probably looking for Christmas cheer, but instead she's just screaming at the sky.
Anyway, as promised, I know I meant to debut it last week. We're going to go ahead and finally do it this week. It is the debut of the Pro Bear segment here on the Bear Raid. Initially, of course, we're going to be starting off with talking about the Pro Bears that currently play in the National Football League, and obviously highlight some of the top performers from the NFL that are Pro Bear members of the league, Cal alumni playing in the NFL. Obviously, of course, as well as time goes forward.
Bynum. That's next year.
That's
huh?
next year, Donnie.
I'm getting a little
again. Typical Donnie getting ahead of things.
You know, Bynum. If you got hit by Bynum, you'd have a headache.
It's the debut of this segment, and Donnie's already getting ahead of things.
Bynum. I'm still excited about my Bynum. Is he going to play in the East-West Shrine Game? Or is that canceled too?
I don't even know if they are playing the East-West Shrine Game. Oh, you know, this is one of those years where really I just haven't really, outside of what the program's done, I haven't followed what everybody else is doing. So I don't even know. I was even, you know, I didn't even know about them having bowl games until we heard what was going on with San Jose State. So, Oregon's going
to
be playing in the Rose Bowl, lucky bastards, even though they were second place.
Bynum's going to go high in that draft, eh?
Anyway, what I was alluding to is obviously we'll be starting off with members of the Cal alumni that are in the NFL right now. But the Pro Bear segment, obviously, on future editions of the Bear Raid, will cover Pro Bears in the NBA, in Major League Baseball. Do we have a hockey team at Cal? I don't even remember. Are there any guys from Cal that ever go to the NHL?
I don't know, but we got a lot of football players in the NFL.
Oh, yeah, no doubt. But basically,
that's where I thought you were alluding.
If there's a pro sport, we're going to cover them here on the Pro Bears if they end up doing stuff. And we'll go ahead and touch bases on some of the three standouts from Cal that did things last week in the NFL, since obviously we're coming at you with NFL games for week 15. Still going on right at you right here, right now. Top three Cal performers for last week's week 14 matchups. A familiar name that I'm not shocked to see here at the top of the list, and that's none other than the great quarterback that is Aaron Rodgers. Last week, he was 26 of 33, 290 yards. He threw four total touchdowns. Apparently, news coming out today that he's become now the third NFL or the first NFL quarterback to ever have three straight 40-plus touchdown seasons. So just Aaron continuing to just add to his Pro Bear resume. Tyson
Alau.
Tyson Alau was, of course, up here as well on the defensive side. Four tackles, one sack, one forced fumble, and one QB hurry for the Pittsburgh Steelers last week. And then another individual up there, the third top performer for your Pro Bears in Week 14, is a familiar, well, kind of familiar face, you know, kind of seems familiar, but not really kind of familiar, is Keenan Allen. Nine receptions, 52 yards, and one touchdown last week. And
he burned it up when he was a Bear.
Oh yeah, definitely did. Tore it up there, and you know, he's starting to add on, and you know, starting now to become one of the, you know,
premier,
well, not really premier NFL receivers, but he's starting to slowly take down some long time career receiving records for the Chargers down
he's
there.
Back in the Ted Head days, remember old Ted Head?
Definitely old Ted Head. And that is it for this Pro Bears edition, Pro Bears segment for this edition of the show. Definitely, like I said, we're going to look at what some of the Pro Bears do week in and week out in the NFL and in the other pro sports that Cal Bears happen to in have their claws implanted around the pro sports world. Let's go ahead now and take a look at standings around the Pac-12 conference. Go ahead and begin things here with what the final standings ended up being for the Pac-12 football conference in 2020. Over in the Pac-12 North, the Huskies finished up on top with a record of 3-1. The Stanford Cardinal were in second with a record of 4-2. The Oregon Ducks were in third with a record of 3-2 and currently are ranked 25th in the country. The Oregon State Beavers finished off with a record of 2-5. And your California Golden Bears and the Washington State Cougars finished tied for the basement in 2020 with records of 1-3. Over in the Pac-12 South, the USC Trojans finished off the season, of course, with a record of 5-0. They obviously, of course, as we all know, dropped the Pac-12 championship against the Ducks yesterday. They're currently ranked 21st in the country. Colorado Buffalo finished off with a record of 3-1. The Utah Utes finished off with a record of 3-2. Arizona State finished out 2-2. The UCLA Dickless Bears finished out at 3-4. And the Arizona Wildcats finished out the season as losers with a record of 0-5. Your thoughts on Pac-12 football in 2020?
Sad. I thought Cal was going to finish a lot better than that. I thought we were going to have a lot more games and we were going to have a lot more fun. I'm looking forward to next year. You know, I always look forward to the optimist. Oregon, you know, they deserve what they got. They're pretty tough. They always recruit well. Washington, I didn't think they would even get a chance to play in the final game. I mean, you know, and in the end, as you know, they didn't. But I think next year I'm looking at Oregon State and Cal in the top in the NorCal. On the South, you got to give it back to UCLA. And, you know, UCLA is going to be pretty good next year in the South.
But definitely you won't be shocked, obviously, as well, that the Trojans will probably have their say in
the South as well. Next year I got UCLA.
So you think SC is going to squander a bit in 2021?
Well, I hope they do.
Well, we'll see what happens with that. Again, it was a season where initially we were expected to be 23rd ranked nationally. Obviously, because of COVID and other stuff, that ended up not being the case. So definitely let's pray and hope. You know, I'm not expecting everybody from the 2021 recruitment class to have an immediate impact on the team. A lot of stuff's going to depend, obviously, on how many guys, you know, from the program graduated, who decides to come back, who decides to leave early for the draft, if anybody decides to. So definitely will be real interesting to see how things shape out with this for not just Cal, but the rest of the conference as well, as they all try to lick their wounds and recover from a wacky 2020 season and get ready to reload the guns for the 2021 season. Let's go ahead and take a look now at how things are shaping up with the basketball aspect of things around basketball in the Pac-12. We'll go ahead and, because I guess forgot to click on it for the ladies, we'll start off looking at the men's standings first here for the Pac-12 basketball programs. Currently, there are six teams tied for first place in the Pac-12, as currently in conference play, Washington State, Oregon, Utah, UCLA, Stanford, and Arizona State are all 1-0. Overall, Washington State is 6-0. The Oregon Ducks are 6-1. Utah Utes are 4-1. UCLA is 5-2. Stanford is 4-2. And Arizona State is 4-3. The Oregon State Beavers in conference play are 0-1. They're 3-3 overall. The USC Trojans and Colorado Buffalo have yet to play conference matchups on their schedules. Overall record for them are both 4-1 at this time. Arizona Wildcats are 0-1 in conference play. They're 5-1 overall. Your California Golden Bears are currently 0-2 in conference play and are 4-4 overall. And the Washington Huskies are also 0-2 in conference play and have a 1-5 overall
record. That's right, Hank. Very good. You know, next year, I was just thinking, you told the story about Tightwad Hill today in your Keith's Corner. Next year I'm making lasagna. I'm going to bring a bottle of wine, and I'm going to ask Bert if he wants my lasagna.
Somebody's going to probably still try to ruin it and be like, Donnie's me!
They're still going to make fun of my lasagna, huh?
Probably make fun of lasagna, make fun of the meat, make fun of
everything.
The
big meatballs in the lasagna.
The funny thing is everybody loves it, but then they still find a way to make some joke or make some wisecrack at it.
Right, it'll be good lasagna, don't worry.
Here is how things are finally shaping up as we take a look at the last set of standings here for Cal Athletics on this edition of the show, and that is, of course, the Pac-12 conference standings for the ladies' basketball programs. The Arizona Wildcats, who are ranked 6th of the nation, are currently 5-0 overall in conference play and 6-0 overall. The 7th-ranked Oregon Ducks are 2nd in the conference at 4-0 in conference play and 6-0 overall as well. And the number 1-ranked Stanford Cardinal are currently 3-0 in conference play and are also 6-0. So you got basically the top three teams are all overall 6-0 and are holding down three of the top 10 spots in the nation right now. The Washington State Cougars are in the 4th spot at 2-0 in conference play, 3-0 overall. The 11th-ranked UCLA Bruins are 3-1 in conference play, 5-1 overall. Arizona State is 2-2 in conference play, 6-2 overall. Utah is 2-3 in conference play. They're 3-3 overall. Oregon State, they're ranked 21st in the country, is 1-3 in conference play and 3-3 overall. Washington State is 1-3 in conference play, 3-3 overall. Colorado is 1-3 in conference play as well, and they're 4-3 overall. Your California Golden Bears, they're 0-3 in conference play, and they're 0-6 overall, unfortunately, at this point in time. And down at the bottom at 0-4 in conference play and 1-4 overall are the USC Trojans. So so far at this point in time, things are not looking real good for your Lady Golden Bears. So just guess the best thing you can say is the best to do is just look up this point and try to bounce back.
Get some new uniforms, get some candy canes, check your stockings, and come out for the new year. Wow, I didn't expect that from my girls.
Definitely not, and it's definitely not what I was expecting either, based on some of the talks that we were having before we started doing the show, some of the preliminary stuff we saw out there, and again, some of the past
they
performances.
They really had
program.
Them docked up in the beginning.
But, you know, hey, things could happen, man. The team can, you know, all it takes is, you know, one game or a couple games where you beat an opponent, you get on a hot streak, and that could turn things around, you know, just at this point in time, you know, given, you know, I don't, you know, really got to take a look to see how much farther on down the road the schedule's going to go for not just the ladies, but for the men as well in basketball, you know, because you're trying to still sit and figure out, are we going to have, you know, March Madness like we normally would expect, or is that going to be affected and altered because of COVID as well? Going forward, who knows how many, you know, games are going to be left, and obviously how many of those games will be able to be played out depending on if anyone pops for COVID at some point, either for Cal or any of their opponents. So just, you know, ladies, all they need is just that one game or a couple games where they could swing the momentum back in their favor. But it's going to be a real tough, you know, to, I think, bounce back from an 0-6 start.
Well said, Keith. You know, I like to give out a couple of gold basketballs, but I don't have one for the ladies this month, you know, this week. But I'm going to give one to Macaulay Foreman with that swish against the U.S., you know, Dons there. Kicked their booty, end of the game. So Foreman, he gets my gold basketball. First one I ever gave out.
I thought you gave him the gold basketball last week.
Well, he got some nutsack last week,
oh,
you know.
Boy. On that note, Donnie, why don't you go ahead and lead us on out of here with your final thought of the afternoon.
I think we did all right, baby. We're having a good time down here. We're all around the Christmas tree. Stay home. Send out your cards. Call your mom. Wish her well. Tell all your loved ones that you love them. Tell Keith you love them. And we'll get back at you.
As always, ladies and gentlemen, for the latest information pertaining to the Bear Raid presented by Tightwad Hill, be sure to check things out at facebook.com/TightwadHillOfficial. Follow things on Twitter at TightwadHill23. Check out the Bear Raid page over on AceFanRadio.com/The Bear Raid presented by Tightwad Hill. And, of course, you can always view the live broadcasts of the show right here on twitch.tv/AceFanRadio. And in case you missed any of the past broadcasts or there's something that you may have missed during this broadcast, in case you stepped away to do some medical research, take a leak, go on a beer run, and you want to see what you missed with this or any of our other past broadcasts, then make your way over to Ace Fan Radio's YouTube channel where you can catch all of the past editions of the Bear Raid. Our next broadcast, of course, will be coming at you 2 weeks from now, as again, we'll be taking 2 weeks off for the holiday season and be coming at you with show number 7 of the Bear Raid on January the 10th at 3 p.m. Pacific Standard Time here from the Concord Cottage on twitch.tv/AceFanRadio. Once again, I cannot continue to sit here and reiterate it and remind you of what Santa's elves are probably saying up at the North Pole right now to all of you, and that is, of course, ho, 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 stay yo ass at home. Again,
mask up, baby.
Mask up. Don't travel. I got into it, unfortunately, with a friend from high school yesterday in regards to my thoughts on the fact that I still see a lot of people out there not getting their priorities straight on what is happening with this pandemic. And then today, it was very unfortunate of me to happen to see the same individual that I got into it with traveling around the country over in Texas right now. So, you know, not only are you getting into it with, you know, me and questioning my standpoint and questioning some of the data out there, now you're out there doing what you shouldn't be doing and has been advised not to do, is travel. You know, just please, people. I understand you're getting antsy. I understand you're getting frustrated. We're all hurting. We're all struggling in some form or way capacity because of this. But do not let that, you know, cause you to get to the point where you let your guard down and start not giving a damn about the man, woman, child to your left or your right. Just continue to do what you got to do to be safe out there. Mask up, socially distance, keep things limited to those that are in your household as best as you can, and let's just continue to do what we can to quell this thing and then do what we need to do until everybody is able to get access to the various forms of the vaccination out there. Because the fact that, hey, I would love to be able to do this show in the basement of Pappy's or somewhere over in Berkeley. I have no issue doing it out of a garage next to the Concord Cottage, but I'd love to be able to get back to the point where I'm doing stuff like this in person and hanging out with people that we know in person. But as long as this pandemic continues to run rampant because people don't want to get their priorities straight and continue to not take the seriousness of this, then that's not going to happen. People, we're losing a 9/11 a day to this crap. I want to say yesterday it was almost a 9/11 twice in a day yesterday. You know, you got to start getting things prioritized and, you know, do a better job. And obviously applaud and you know, applause to all of you out there who are like me and like Donnie, who are actually doing what needs to be done to make sure that you don't catch this and spread this. And, you know, it's just, we got to do a better effort of harping it down those that are out there that are not doing it, because those are the ones ultimately that are hurting us. As always, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for tuning in to the Bear Raid presented by Tightwad Hill. Y'all take care and enjoy the rest of your Sunday afternoon.
Roll on, you Bears. Oh.
views and opinions of our cast, our guests, and our listeners are in no way, shape, or form affiliated with the University of California Golden Bears, Cal Athletics, or the NCAA, or the Pac-12 Conference. Thank you again, as always, for tuning in to this broadcast. Please, again, be safe out there. Don't do anything dumb. Continue to follow the guidelines. Continue to mask up. Just do what you got to do so that way we can begin to slowly get things back to some form of normalcy in the coming months. Y'all take care. Enjoy your holidays. We will see you again in a little over 2 weeks for show number 7 of the Bear Raid, which again will be coming at you on January the 10th at 3 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Take care. Be safe until then. And as always, ladies and gentlemen, go Bears! Take care, y'all.